come today because this is a very special occasion. We have the composer of these works in our midst. Doesn't happen very often in a lifetime. We also have our sponsors, Ian and Aggie Graham, who commissioned two of the works we'll be playing today with us. So we have asked John Psathas if he would please introduce the works for us. So please, can you give a very warm welcome to this very special man, John Psathas.
Thank you very much, and it's great to be here. I love coming to Waikato, and it's a fantastic space. It's great to be with the Zealand Chamber Soloists again. It's always quite weird to be asked to talk about one's own music to an audience, because a couple of things. One is I could talk for hours, and the other thing is it would be great to not say anything and allow the music to speak for itself. So you kind of get caught in between these two things. So I just thought I'd say a few words about each piece before we hear each of the pieces, so I might pop up and down. The first piece we're going to hear is Island Songs, which is probably the, next to A Little Solo Waiting for the Aeroplane, probably the oldest piece of mine that has wonderfully survived and is still being performed after all of these years. This piece was originally written for a trio that had a clarinet instead of a piano, violin, for the Kandinsky trio, going all the way back.
Ensemble.
The Kandinsky Ensemble, yes. And then I made another version of that to replace the clarinet with a violin, and that's really the version that lives these days. So the Island Songs is in three movements. It was written in the 90s, which is feeling further and further back. And it was really my first, I suppose, testing the waters of expressing something of my other heritage, the heritage from Greece. And so there are three movements, and they all have elements of Greek folk music in them. And what's interesting about the whole program today is that we will go from this to Korybas to Helix. And as we move into the later pieces, there's more and more of an embracing and eventually a real celebrating of things that I've learned from music from that part of the world. But Island Songs was really my baby steps in that area. So there are three movements, and they're all roughly based on dance. Roughly because I don't dance, and so I don't really have a connection with that kind of physical movement, so it's all done up here. The first one is based on a very simple melodic idea in the left hand of the piano, and if you listen, you'll hear that go all the way through the movement in various guises. And the cello and the violin have a kind of almost a stunted presence with these short notes, but then they burst out of the song and then they come back to them. So there's this thing about voice energy in that movement. The second is for the cello, either a dream or a nightmare, I'm not sure which one it is, because it's got this, I think, very beautiful, but I think fantastically challenging as well. Pizzicato, four note chords, moving around quite a lot, but it's a slow kind of dance, and in Greece there is a dance called the Zubeko dance, which is the men doing this very slowly, and they go down on their knees and pick up the spirit in the glass and put it back down. It has this whole thing to it. And the last movement is very, very spirited, very fast and fiery, and is a kind of, I suppose, sort of music you would hear in the islands, maybe of Greece. There's just a very interesting point of distinction between music in Greece that's in the islands, music that's up in the mountains. If you go up to Epidos near the Albanian border and so on, up in the mountains, they're very, very cold, so people wear very heavy clothing, and so they dance quite slowly, because they have a lot of weight on the body. But if you go to the islands, people wear next to nothing, and the dancing is very fast and very spirited, and sort of people leaping about. So those are the three movements. This is Island Songs. I'm going to enjoy.
Thank you.
Thank you. quite sure if I was supposed to come up. This is a very special piece because it was commissioned by somebody for their partner's birthday. It was a gift. It's a work as a gift. And it's interesting to think about what impacts on the composer when they're creating a work, because there are many, many things. Pretty much everything impacts on the composer when they're creating something new. But this in particular, I think, it was very important to me that it qualifies as that kind of music. It's music that would be a gift from one person to another. So I needed to find a way in to this piece, because what does it mean? I don't know enough about people to know what they would like, and also in the end I can only write what I can write. But there is a way of aligning things, bringing things together. So I found out through Ian that Nagy was keen on certain kinds of orchids. One's called Koribas, which is also, they call that because they have a helmet type shape, and the helmet is ancient Phrygian soldiers, I think, that wore these helmets. But these particular people were also really into a wilder kind of dance. So we're getting closer and closer to something that I could find a way into as a composer. And so I brought that way of thinking together with something that I was particularly interested in musically at the time, which was a time signature. And this is the kind of obsessive, fetishist people that composers can be, which is I was just spending a lot of time thinking about one time signature and what one might do in that time signature. And so this time signature was 17 beats, and it was organized in a certain way. So there's a 6 and a 4 and a 7, and the 6 and a 4 extended version of the 7, all these different relationships and so on. I spent lots of time playing with this, and it really is like kids with toys at a creche playing. It's really this amazing thing that is happening. And so a really big part of Koribas is in this time signature. Doesn't matter if you know that or not, but you will feel a kind of elasticity in the rhythm and hopefully enjoy that. The other thing that I would say about this piece is that unlike what we just heard, which ends big, it has a kind of momentum that flows beyond the end of the work, so that if you're listening to it and you've enjoyed it, feel like clapping when it finishes. This piece has a very long, slow tail down to nothing. And it's quite interesting for me, when I sit here and listen to the works, to feel just when a piece ends, that moment, just before people clap, is such a profound moment for a composer. Firstly, terrified, will anybody clap? But in this piece, it's very interesting because the energy of the work, the end of the work, is really one about, you just have a moment. It's a very, very interesting kind of phenomenon. It's like the end of Wagner opera with 20 minutes of the tonic triad at the end. It just resolves itself. And then the other thing that I would just say is just how pieces start, which is do you want to play just the first few bars? Failing and the 20 minutes were succeeding. And it's very interesting with an idea like this that it doesn't seem like that much, but it takes a really long time for me to get to that point where there's an idea that I know somehow is going to be the seed for a whole composition. And it's one of the ineffable things about composing. You don't know how you know it, but you know that you do know it.
Thank you.
quite an epic undertaking as well. It contains a lot of results from my a period of time I did a lot of transcribing of folk music from around the Balkans, Middle East, and the Mediterranean. In particular, what I was transcribing from audio to score were recordings of melodic improvisation, because I had become very moved by hearing these things from Arabic cultures and Mediterranean and Eastern European cultures. But it's, you know, from a composer perspective, it's not enough to be moved. You kind of really want to understand why it does what it does. And because so much of this is not yet documented or researched or written about in accessible ways, the only solution for the composer is to actually get a recording and sit down and write it out. That sounds easy, but in fact it takes a really, really long time. It took me a long time anyway. I transcribed some very detailed and melodic improvisation on clarinet and violin, like Egyptian violin, Balkan clarinet, and the duduk from Armenia as well. And from that, learned some really incredible secrets, I think, about why so much of that music can be so powerful. And the actual information is, in the end, it's quite mundane, but unless you go looking for it, you don't really know. And what you'll hear in this composition, in all three movements, in the melodic writing, which is particularly for the string instruments, is there is a tendency to start a melodic phrase quite slowly and accelerate into the center of it, and then once the peak of the phrase is gone, to slow down as one leaves. And this is a beautiful thing, and you hear it in Chopin, for instance, rubato playing in the right hand of the left hand. And it sounds very natural. And what you'll hear, it will sound very natural. You saw the score, you'll understand what the performers have been through to get to the point to make it sound very natural, because the transcription itself ends up in quite a detailed rhythmic notation in order to simulate this kind of fluidity of flow in the melody. So that was a kind of technical, probably reasonably boring explanation of how I got to this, but this is the life of the composer, this is what we do. So the first movement also has the results of my exploration of ancient Greek music. I spent quite a bit of time looking at and listening to whatever artifacts and remnants still exist for us from around about 500 BC to about 100 AD, and it really is a phenomenal time. They were pretty smart. The melody writing was beautiful, rhythmically really advanced, tuning-wise, very, very sophisticated, things we haven't heard until the second half of the 20th century again. And so that's that first movement. The second movement is called The Biggest Nothing of Them All, and that's a quote from the movie Apocalypse Now, in which I think the French were leaving and the Americans were arriving in Vietnam, and this one character said, you know, we come here to fight over nothing. I think this place is the biggest nothing of them all. And it's a kind of elegy. We don't have to look very far in the world to find places where that's relevant. And the last movement is called Tarantismo, and it's an example of a piece of music that is in the tarantella type rhythm, which is from Italy. It's usually 6/8, and this piece is 3/8, 6/8, 9/8, 12/8, changes a lot. But the idea is that once bitten by a tarantula, you would dance to take out the toxin from the body. Interesting, when you read about the birth of that idea, it sort of seemed to have coincided with a ban on dancing in the same place, and maybe it was really about, I've been bitten by a spider, and that's why I'm dancing. It was a way of having an opportunity. Anyway, this is it's a big piece, and it's a piece that I love, so I enjoy. Thank you.
John wrote Kodivasi found he had another piece in him still, and so this for Ian's commission for Aggie's birthday, and he called it Aegean, inspired by the view from his parents' window. His parents have returned to live in Greece. They live in Thessaloniki, and they're looking out over the Aegean, a great window looking out over the still, huge grey sea with blue when we were there, but apparently it's grey in the photo. And Aegean is also a